Today we learn about the bone humerus. This is the humerus bone. It is a bone of an arm. And this is the longest bone of upper limb. It can be studied under three parts. First one, this is the upper end. And this is the shaft, elongated shaft. And this is the lower end. The first we'll concentrate on the upper end. This is the upper end. In the upper end, this is the head, which is rounded and it forms one third of the spear. This head articulates with the glenoid cavity of the scapula to form shoulder joint. Encircling this head, there is the constricted part that is known as anatomical neck. Total this upper end, it is separated from the shaft. Here there is a neck that is known as surgical neck. Surgical neck, it is the neck which separates the total upper end from the shaft. That is known as surgical neck. Here it will be. Below the surgical neck, 5 cm below the surgical neck, we'll see the morphological neck. It indicates an epiphyseal line. So, three necks. First one is anatomical neck, surgical neck and morphological neck. After completion of the neck, we'll see about the tubercles. An elevation which is projected from the anterior part of the upper end, it is known as lesser tubercle. And an elevation which is projected on its lateral part of the upper end, that is known as greater tubercle, this one. This is the lesser tubercle, this bony prominence which is seen on the anterior part of the upper end, and this is an elevation which is seen on the lateral aspect of the upper end, known as greater tubercle. In between two tubercles, we will see intertubercular sulcus. This intertubercular sulcus is also known as bicipital groove. This is nothing but a prolongation of lesser and greater tubercle. So this completes the upper end. First one is head. This head should face upwards, backwards and medially. This is the shaft having three borders and three surfaces. This is the anterior border and this is the medial border and this is the lateral border. Now first we'll see about the anterior border. This is the anterior border. It is most prominent in the upper one third and middle one third. Whereas in the lower one third, this anterior border is ill-defined and rounded. In the upper one third, this anterior border forms the lateral lip of the bicipital groove. This is the bicipital groove. Its lateral lip forms the lateral margin, forms the anterior border in the upper one third. Whereas in the middle one third, this is the deltoid tuberosity. Anterior margin of the deltoid tuberosity will form the middle one-third of the anterior border. Whereas in the lower one-third, it is ill-defined and rounded. This is about the anterior border. Now we'll see the medial border. This is the medial border. The medial margin of the bicipital groove will form the upper one-third of the medial border. Whereas in the middle one third of the medial border, we'll see a roughened ridge here. This is the medial border. Upper one third of the medial border, it is formed by the medial lip of bicipital groove. Whereas in the middle one third of the medial border, it is formed by a roughened ridge. In the lower one third, it continues as the medial supracondylar ridge. This is about the medial border. Now we'll see the lateral border. This lateral border, it is most prominent in the lower part than the upper part. In the upper part, this lateral border is ill-defined, but roughly we can assume it starts just behind the posterior surface of the greater tubercle. And it is most prominent on the lower part, which continues as the lateral supracondylar ridge. Now we'll see the surfaces. The surfaces are three. First one is anteromedial surface, which is seen between the anterior border and the medial border. Between these two borders, the surface is anteromedial surface. The next surface is anterolateral surface, which is seen between the anterior border and the lateral border. This surface is the anterolateral surface. And the third surface is posterior surface. This posterior surface, which is seen between the medial border and the lateral border. Between these two borders, we'll see the posterior surface. Now we'll see the details about the surfaces. First one is anteromedial surface. This is the anteromedial surface. In the middle one third of the anteromedial surface, we'll see one ridge, a roughened ridge. And at the middle one third of the medial border, we'll see the nutrient foramen. And now we'll see about the anterolateral surface. This is the anterolateral surface. Just above the middle, we'll see a V-shaped deltoid tuberosity in the anterolateral surface. This is the V-shaped deltoid tuberosity. Below the deltoid tuberosity, we'll see a groove. Look here, this is the groove which is coming from the posterior surface. This groove is known as a radial groove. This is about the anterolateral surface. Now we'll see the posterior surface. In the posterior surface, we'll see in the upper part, upper one third, we'll see an oblique ridge. This is the oblique ridge. Below the oblique ridge, we'll see one groove in its middle one third of the posterior surface. This is the radial groove. This radial groove, which extends downwards, forwards, and it is slightly extended towards the anterolateral surface like this. This is the radial groove, which is extending from the posterior surface towards the anterolateral surface. These are the features seen in the surfaces. Now we'll see the lower end. This is the lower end. This lower end, it can be studied by two parts. One is articular part and next one is non-articular part. First we'll see about the articular part. This rounded bulge, it is known as a capitulum, which articulates with the head of the radius. This is the pulley shaped bone, which is known as trochlea, which articulates with the trochlear notch of ulna. Look here, the medial border or medial flange of trochlea is slightly extended downwards at a range of 6 mm than the lateral edge. Due to this, the carrying angle is formed. These two parts come under the articular part. Now we'll see about the non-articular part. The fossa, which is located just above the capitulum on the anterior aspect, it is known as the radial fossa. It allows the accommodation for the head of the radius while during the flexion of elbow. And above the level of the trochlea, we'll see the coronoid fossa. Comes in contact with the trochlear notch of ulna while the elbow is flexed. On the back, just behind the coronoid fossa, we'll see the olecranon fossa. This is the olecranon fossa. This olecranon fossa articulates with the olecranon process of the ulna.
when the elbow is extended. Now we'll see the condyles. This is the medial epicondyle, which is large and it is easily felt on the skin and it is subcutaneous. This is the lateral epicondyle, which is small. Above the medial epicondyle, this ridge is known as medial supracondylar ridge. Above the lateral epicondyle, this ridge is known as the lateral supracondylar ridge. This is the extension of an medial border and this is the extension of lateral border. All these parts comes under the non-articular part. This medial epicondyle, medial supracondylar ridge, lateral epicondyle, lateral supracondylar ridge. Above the capitulum is the radial fossa. Above the trochlea is known as the coronoid fossa. Behind the trochlea, we'll see another fossa that is known as olecranon fossa, which accommodates the olecranon process of ulna while the elbow is extended. But these two parts comes under the articular part, capitulum and trochlea. Now we'll see the site determination of the humerus. The head should face upwards, backwards and medially. This is the head which should face upwards, backwards and medially. The lower end, which is expanded side to side and it is flattened anteroposteriorly. And the olecranon fossa at its lower end should face us posteriorly. By these things, we can keep the humerus in position. This is the bone of right side.